Music. It's the love of music that brings us together. The love of music that forms the bond between us. For the next hour, join us for the love of music, presenting those aspects of music which excite, provoke, and inspire. Our host today is David Dubal, WNCN Music Director, pianist, educator, and writer on music. Here is David Dubal for the love of music.
The waltz you have just heard, all 12 seconds of it, is titled For a Happy Occasion. And it is indeed a very happy occasion that I am speaking to Virgil Thomson. It is Virgil Thomson's 85th birthday on November 24th, and this month, WNCN pays him tribute. He himself wrote in a personal statement, "I was born in Kansas City, Missouri, grew up there, and went to war from there. That was the other war. Then I was educated some more in Boston and Paris. In composition, I was chiefly the pupil of Nadia Boulanger. While I was still young, I taught music at Harvard and played the organ at King's Chapel, Boston. Then I returned to Paris and lived there for many years, until after the Germans came, in fact. From 1940 to 1954, I was music critic of the New York Herald Tribune. I still live in New York." These simple sentences are only a skeleton for one of the great careers in music. A composer of remarkable diversity and creativity, the author of books, including the celebrated The State of Music, The Musical Scene, The Art of Judging Music, Music Right and Left, Virgil Thomson by Virgil Thomson, his autobiography, and American Music Since 1910. John Cage wrote of Thomson that his position in relation to the art of music is that of an independent mystic in relation to established religion. Indeed, Virgil Thomson is one of the few famous living composers, a man of profundity and humor. And this week and next, I will be talking with him, and during this month, his music will regularly be broadcast over WNCN. Keynote Magazine will provide the listings and the times of broadcast. Virgil, thank you for coming to talk to me.
Well, it's been a pleasure.
Virgil, I'm going to ask you several questions, and the first one will be, in reading your autobiography, it seems to attest to a very full and happy childhood in Kansas City. You adored your mother, who thought life should be one long party. I get the feeling that you believed her, and that for you, at least, it all came true.
Well, when you're a child, you don't make up your mind to general ideas like that. And, of course, all children get persecuted by their contemporaries, bullied, beaten up, tortured, and they suffer a bit from it. But you also have your chums and your fun. And I actually liked school, you know.
I know you did.
And I practiced the piano. I didn't like practicing the piano, but I loved playing it. And as my mother pointed out, if you want to play the piano, you have to practice. And so I did. Actually, I could not be said to have had an unhappy childhood.
Well, that's the impression
I got. It wasn't
merely
that I loved my parents. Children will love anybody. Mm. What I'm so grateful for is that my parents loved me.
How nice. You practiced your piano, and your cousin, I think, introduced you to piano lessons.
She gave me my first piano lessons,
yes. But your father, you write, was actually tone deaf almost.
Well, he couldn't tell one tune from another.
So he never really was able to appreciate your work at all?
Oh, he respected my motivation.
Uh-huh. What were the big musical happenings of your childhood, and what were the sounds of your childhood musically?
Well, the big happenings were either playing music in public, which I did from time to time. That got me started off as an old ham.
But you got paid very early for your work. You liked being a professional.
Well, I didn't get paid until I had a little church job at the age of 12. I got paid $5 a Sunday for playing the organ. And at the same age, I used to play the piano at a neighborhood movie, for which I got $1 a night.
Mm-hmm. Those were exciting times, though, for you.
Well, a dollar was money in 1909.
Now, growing up in Kansas City, you heard ragtime, perhaps?
Oh, everybody played ragtime.
And, of course, it has certainly stuck in your ear because you have written music with an evocation of ragtime in it.
Ragtime was the was our background music in white circles.
Mm-hmm.
In black circles, I think jazz was already beginning to be their normal background.
Mm-hmm. Now, I've known you...
Ragtime was a black invention, but it was it circulated among the whites, and the blacks developed after that, not necessarily from it, but after that. By 1912, even our high school dancers had little jazz orchestras to play for us.
What was Kansas City, Missouri, famous for when you were growing up? The ragtime? The steaks?
It was famous for the stockyards and the packing houses.
Yeah.
Along with Omaha and Chicago, we prepared all the meat that you ate.
That's right. Now, what were the other musical sounds? You went to church a great deal.
Oh, well, my family were Southern Baptists, and I was obliged to go to church. Then again, by the age of 12, when I was beginning to have organ lessons, I went to church for other purposes, for professional purposes, so to speak.
Mm-hmm. Few American composers grew up with the organ in their background, I think.
I don't know. Maybe some did and some don't. The French composers very frequently tend to grow up with an organ background.
Absolutely. Were you improvising early?
Oh, well, everybody improvises. Every musical child makes up things.
Uh-huh.
I used to, of course, at two, I thought it was composing, but actually it was just standing at the piano with my foot on the loud pedal and playing with full hands, arms, and elbows, great blocks and masses of sound, which I gave names to. I remember there was something I called the Chicago Fire, which was an event which had taken place not too far away from there.
That was your first big opus?
I don't remember them by opuses or by names. But I used to do that. The family thought it was making a lot of noise and a little silly, but they didn't stop me from doing it. And there was a neighbor lady who used to pay me serious compliments for this creative effort.
Virgil Thomson is my guest, and we're discussing aspects of his childhood. Virgil, however, your first title, The Chicago Fire, it does have a meaning in a way because you've always been a good title maker.
Well, the Chicago Fire was a current event which had taken place sometime in the late 90s or middle 90s, early 90s. I don't know. I was born in 1896,
mm-hmm.
and the Chicago Fire was still being talked about when I was a small child.
What were the big musical events in Kansas City? Did big-name soloists like Paderewski come?
Well, the big-name soloists all came and played there,
mm-hmm.
because we were either a terminus or a changing engine point for 22 railways. Everybody crossing the continent of America went through Kansas City.
Mm-hmm. Now, when you finally left Kansas City, it was actually to be in World War I.
I went to war, same regiment with Harry Truman, a local regiment of National Guard of Mounted Artillery.
Was he a private like you?
No, he was captain.
Uh-huh.
I was private. He's a little older.
Well, you eventually did become a Louisville colonel, a Kentucky colonel.
Yes, but that required no military preparation.
Now, after you had your Army experience, you went to Boston. and there you studied at Harvard.
I went to Harvard as an undergraduate, yes.
Yes. Now, during that war, I think many musicians, though, suffered, like the conductor of the Boston Symphony, Karl Muck. He was actually interned in a camp. German music was out. Was that the period where we were getting some knowledge of the new French developments in music? Because
well,
your teacher...
Well, the new French developments in music were beginning to be known in America long before World War I and were played by the German conductors in New York, Boston, and Chicago. Karl Muck, who was the conductor of the Boston Symphony, was caught sending messages from his Cape Cod house by lights out to submarines. So he was arrested and sent to jail. But the composer, Carl Ruggles, was conducting an orchestra in Minnesota, not far from Minneapolis. And his orchestra consisted almost entirely of German citizens. Mm-hmm. So when we entered the war, German citizens could no longer hold jobs. Matter of fact, they sometimes got arrested or whatever you do with enemy aliens in wartime.
Now, at Harvard, there was a great influence on your career, certainly a man who knew French music probably better than anyone around at that time, E.B. Hill.
Oh, yes, Edward Burlingame Hill. He was my advisor in the music department. And I assisted him in his courses, and he actually gave courses in French music, among other things.
But you didn't study composition yet with him.
Sure. He taught me to orchestrate.
Uh-huh. Okay, because I ask about him because it's so well known of your tenure as a student with Nadia Boulanger that I wanted to get Mr. Hill in here.
Well, I learned choral writing from Archibald Davison, commonly known as Doc, who was conductor of the Harvard Glee Club and a professor in the music department. Also, I was an assistant to him. I learned a great deal about vocal writing at that time, previously backed up by the fact that I'd played accompaniments for singers in Kansas City a great deal.
Yes.
I had a lot of acquaintance with the human voice.
After Harvard, and during those years, you played at the King's Chapel in Boston, the organ, where you, as you said, played the funerals and the weddings and so forth to make extra money. You were always on your own, though, from the beginning. There was no real funding for you. You had to scrounge around.
And what do you mean on my own?
Well, you didn't have big patrons or anything. You had to always earn your living.
When I was young, I earned my living mostly, except what I could scrounge out of the family, which didn't have very much.
Yeah.
Not that my family was ungenerous, but in our generation, we were not rich. So that I played the organ and assisted in the music department to put myself through Harvard. I also had some scholarships. You know those big famous places like Harvard, Yale, and so forth are absolutely lousy with free money.
Mm-hmm. So you got a little of that.
Oh, yes. Now, anybody bright can get scholarships.
I see. Virgil, you then decided that was enough for America this time, and you wanted to move out, and the big place for you would be Paris. You came to this exciting city, which... How was it musically when you came around, what, 1922?
Well, Paris was very active musically. It was the most active city in France, the most active country musically. Italy was not well organized for musical pedagogy, although there were some excellent musicians. Of course, Germany had been thoroughly impoverished and disorganized by World War I and by the enormous inflation, which had sent the mark to 1 million to the dollar. Mm. So that it was not that easy or desirable to study music in Germany And England was a little bit on the sidelines. But France was the home of the most advanced composers that anybody yes. knew. Not only the French ones, but the Russian ones, like Stravinsky and Prokofiev. They'd had their debuts in Paris before World War I.
What was the Paris like then, in the 20s and 30s, as compared to now? You've been back many times.
Well, it's awfully hard to explain, simply because there were so many tiny little details which were different. To begin with, nobody had telephones. There were telephones in business houses and hotels. But almost nobody you knew, except a few rich people, had telephones. So that you had a little black book in your pocket, and every time you met your friends, or rather every time you said goodbye to them, you took out the little books and made a date and wrote it down to see them the next time, and you kept that date. Mm-hmm. Nobody changed his opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you did, if this was an emergency, you sent a little telegram, a little blue telegram called a pneumatique.
Now, you were in an atmosphere, a bursting city with talent. It had everybody there. Not since the 1830s in Paris had Paris been, I think, so full of musical talent, literary talent, and many Americans were there. I've known you for a long time, and I have really never met anyone that seemed or seems to me as secure an individual as you are, almost fearless, even though you have a glimmer in your eye most of the time, a little twinkle. Have you ever had doubts about yourself, about your talents?
Even your family doesn't believe in you until they read about it in the newspaper. And you don't really believe that you'll ever again write another good work. The firm belief that you have lost your talent is actually a pretty good sign that you're about to start a new piece.
That's
but,
interesting.
You know, we all go up and down.
Let's now hear music. Virgil Thomson's Sea Piece with Birds from Three Pictures for Orchestra, performed here by the Philadelphia Orchestra with the composer himself conducting. You have just heard Sea Peace with Birds from the Three Pictures for Orchestra by Virgil Thomson, performed by Thomson, the orchestra, the Philadelphia Orchestra, and we will be right back after these messages. Victor Yellen wrote, Virgil, that your main contribution to American music is your blending of the musical elements of melody, harmony, and rhythm into a musical style proper to American speech. Others, Foster, Ives, Gershwin, have captured aspects of the American cadence, but only Thomson, writes Yellen, only Thomson's music provides a consistent, uniform, and therefore classic model of American musical speech, unencumbered by stylistic mannerisms or personal eccentricity. Thomson not only created a style for himself, but also a serviceable procedure that other composers may use without imitating Thomson's particular gestures or falling into avant-gardism. Mr. Thomson, do you agree with this verdict? Could you elaborate on it and explain it? And can you tell me if others have used your innovations?
Well, this is a matter in which I've always been quite skillful, which is the words and music operation. And I suppose I'm probably among all the English-speaking composers still probably the most varied and skillful in my handling of the English language. It is a part of any composer's technique if he wants to write vocal music, and everybody does at some point. There's no composer who didn't ever not write vocal music.
Now, why has the English language caused so many problems? It seems that it...
Well, you see, the... the German pedagogues who brought us up and who brought up our teachers all wanted to make us write music that would sound like German music. And the Italian conductors and opera singers and vocal teachers all wanted us to write music which would sound like Italian music. There were perfectly good models in older English music of the 16th and 17th century in which the language sounds like the language. Mm-hmm. But after the English kings became German in the 17th century, then Germans like Handel, for instance, dominated the musical scene. And although Handel himself said English words very neatly to music, the German model remained over-impressive, somehow or other, an established a sophisticated practice with setting English language into music never really got going permanently, either in England or America, and still hasn't. But at no point in England did musical composition and lyric poetry ever quite make the marriage that took place miraculously in Vienna with Franz Schubert. Mm-hmm. You see, before Schubert, it isn't all that good. The songs and little ballads and things of Beethoven and Mozart are sort of stiff. Mm-hmm. And Bach will just barely do for sacred texts. Uh-huh. But with Schubert, it takes on a real amalgamation. That's where the lead starts. Then the lead moved from Germany to France, and it never got anywhere else. It never really flourished in England or Italy or Russia.
We now hear Thomson's Four Songs from William Blake, composed in 1951, expressly for the voice of Mac Harrell, who performs it here with the Philadelphia Orchestra under the direction of Eugene Ormandy.
And love all pray in their distress, and to these virtues of delight return.
Little boy, thou wast thy mother's only joy. Why dost thou weep in thy gentle sleep? Awake, thy father does thee keep. Like a dove, my bone.
land of dreams. But oh, come and warm the waters wide. I could not get to the other side. Father, oh Father, what do we hear? In this land of unbelief and fear, the land of dreams is better far above the light of the morning. Divine shine forth upon our clouded hills, and was Jerusalem builded here among these dark satanic hills?
That was baritone Mac Carroll in a performance of Virgil Thomson's Four Songs from William Blake. Eugene Ormandy led the Philadelphia Orchestra. After these messages, we will return with more conversation with my guest, Virgil Thomson. You knew a lot of literary figures in the Paris of the 20s and 30s, and you knew Hemingway a bit and Fitzgerald and...
Well, I knew most of the French writers, too.
As well. You knew André Gide, and you knew Cocteau. You got around a great deal, and you were, for them, of course, a very remarkable American. Did any of these people, these of the literary world, take any interest in your music?
Well, Gertrude Stein took an interest in my music because I set her to music. Gertrude was not specifically musical, and she wouldn't have noticed it otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
But the the literary people in the mid-20s were much more interested in another American composer who was a close friend of mine. That was George Hantile.
Yeah.
And he was really plugged by Ezra Pound and blessed by Joyce and thoroughly advertised by Sylvia Beach and Adrienne Meunier.
I understand that. And each of these people did take an interest in him, and yet Pound or Joyce or even Beach had no real idea of his music. Is it possible that, I know painters love music very much, is it possible that literary figures don't really understand the art of music?
Well, some are musical and some are not.
Mm-hmm.
And the painters, whether they are have a good musical ear or not, have now all of them practically to a man and to a woman taken to a painting to music. They turn on records or radio or television or something or other while painting is all done to music now.
Yes, that's a pity for...
But you don't write books to music.
No, you have to have silence. Of course you are not just a vocal composer, you have written extensively in the concert forms as well. And you were among the first, in fact, you were among the first in every possible first that an American composer has attempted. In this case, I was saying, you were the first to write, along with Antile and Copland, film scores. And the Plow that broke the plains in 36, and the...
Well, there's the river, and there's the river. Louisiana story.
All right, these are perfect films, though, for you as an American composer, because they are dealing with an emerging America. Do you think...
Well, they're dealing with the American landscape.
Yes, indeed. What happened in your career in this case as a film composer?
Except for one fiction film, which was The Goddess.
Yeah.
I've only done documentaries. You have a much bigger opportunity for musical illustration with documentaries, because you have motion and you have landscape and you're not interfered with by stars. The major opportunities for music at that time I found in the documentaries. I've never signed up to write a lot of films, but I have done 7 or 8, and I've always enjoyed it.
From the album Virgil Thomson, Music from the Films, we now hear The Plow That Broke the Plains.
Thank you.
Neville Mariner conducted the Los Angeles Chamber Orchestra in Virgil Thomson's The Plow That Broke the Plains, written for the film of the same title. Please join me next week for the second half of this interview with Virgil Thomson to honor the composer's 85th birthday. This is David Dubal. Thank you for listening.
For the Love of Music, with today's host, David Dubal, WNCN Music Director. We hope you'll be with us when once again we meet to listen and exchange ideas, all for the love of music. For the Love of Music is produced by WNCN New York, GAF Broadcasting Company.